Shabbat Shalom, everyone. Good morning, Shabbat Shalom. So good to be with you again this morning, and so good to be with my colleagues. We have a lot to talk about. We were going to be doing our series on Elijah. We did Biblical Elijah a couple weeks ago, and we're going to be doing Rabbinic Elijah in the Talmud, and then the news about the Supreme Court about to overturn Roe v. Wade after 50 years came out this week, and that, of course, changed our plans. So let's thank God for the gift of learning Torah together, and then we will have this conversation. So my first question, colleagues, is that when you first read about the leaked draft opinion and the overwhelming likelihood that after 50 years, Roe v. Wade is going to be overturned, how did that make you feel? How did that make you feel? Anyone?
I'll share.
Please.
So I have had, ever since Ruth Bader Ginsburg passed away, I have felt like this was a ticking time bomb and that this was going to be happening in the very near future, and it was not a question of if, but a question of when. And so when the news came out on Monday, even having that preparation and having that anxiety for all of those months, it was really disturbing. And I spent much of the day talking with women in our young adult youth community. And it's just been a week of just feeling really a lot of despair, a lot of heartbreak, a lot of anxiety and worry for myself, for my community, for women in this country, for the financial realities that continue to plague us. It just feels deeply heart-wrenching. And I'm worried not just about that opinion, but about what can happen in our government, the movement to solidify legislation that will make that permanent, even if the Supreme Court, by some miracle, chooses not to go by Alito's opinion.
And, Aliza, when you talk to women in our community, what did you hear? What were some of their concerns that they shared?
Real terror. Real terror.
Terror.
I mean, terror that that women could be placed in life-threatening situations, that through no, you know, there are situations in which you can have an ectopic pregnancy, and that is life-threatening, and that a doctor would be afraid of being persecuted for murder by ending that pregnancy. We've seen that happen in Ireland. We've seen that happen around the world. Terror about the real possibility of not having choice or autonomy, of being placed in a position where you don't get to make decisions about your body. And real fear, you know, outside of our community, most of the women in our community will continue to have access. Massachusetts is a safe space for now. But the real fear about what this does to our country and what this does, we're in the middle of all of these conversations about racial justice and equity and about what happens in our world. And this decision really most affects women who are impoverished and women who are living in the South, and women who are living in places where there's not a lot of upward mobility. And it's going to just deepen the financial inequality. It's going to deepen the racial inequality that exists in our country. And that's also terrifying.
Yes. Colleagues, other, I'd just love to hear first how reading this made you feel. Aliza talked about terror and deepening inequality, et cetera. What were some of your emotional reactions?
Well, as you say, I'm petrified.
Petrified.
Know, yeah, I mean, and my first reaction, you know, goes to my family. Say, what does this mean for Emma? And it's like, as Aliza said, it's terrifying. you know, how does that change everything about her life? You know, I'm thinking more, you know, personal than global, but, you know, global is also very, really significant. I feel like I haven't been able to breathe the whole week, like I'm holding my breath the whole week, just, you know, just caught up with not, when you're stuck, there's nothing, you know, right now there's nothing you can do. We can protest, but what is that going to accomplish? I don't know if it's going to accomplish anything. So it's just feeling stuck and not able to breathe and just not, just being so uncertain about the world.
Mm. So I want to just, not to engage this question now, but I want to engage it at the end, because the words that you're using, like, you know, terror and petrified. My question that I've been struggling with is, how can you deal with this darkness without falling into darkness? How do you deal with darkness without surrendering to darkness? How do you deal with darkness without going dark? And is there a way, and I haven't figured that out, this is a real question, and I don't have the answer, this is a question. My strategy this first week was not very successful. I tried to just avoid the news, because I found that whenever I would read the news, and not only what it means for women and reproductive rights in the ways you've talked about, but what it means for same-sex marriage, I have two gay sons, just the retrenchment of rights, the notion of rights, put me in a dark, dark place, and so I would just follow. Fortunately, Hashem has given us the National Basketball Association playoffs, so I was just avoiding reality and avoiding work and watching great NBA playoffs. And I know that's because the minute I would get back into the actual work of the world, I found the darkness engulfing. And one of the questions I want to ask you, and it's going to turn on what's a synagogue's role, what's our synagogue's role, is how to actually confront darkness without going dark. And I truly would love your wisdom, because I don't have the answer to that question. Anyway, but Elias and Michelle, would love first, just at that first level, how did the news of the week about overturning Roe make you feel?
A little bit what Alisa said, in addition of all the consequences that this will bring to society, and the issue that we all saw it when Ruth Bader, you know, passed away, and the consequences of having a very conservative person, you know, getting to the Supreme Court, we are seeing the consequences of that. It's really surprising to me, because I'm not a historian, I'm not an expert, but it will be interesting to see how many countries had a law that protects women for 50 years or more, and then eventually overturned that. It's strange. It's you know, unusual in a way that societies tend to be more progressive in a way. In general, we are aspiring for a world that could be better in terms of human rights and women's rights and racial and discrimination, and going backwards to the way people thought about things like in the 1960s. It doesn't make any sense to me.
Hmm. And Elias, could you just add one of the fascinating glosses you're always bringing to our conversation and to our community is just the blessing of having come from another culture, or all the complexity of having come from another culture. Can you talk about this issue as it is lived out in Argentina, and this issue as you see it as somebody who immigrated to America as an adult, and what those eyes yield by way of insight?
Yeah, I think that we read here in the Rabbinical Assembly, I think, correct me, colleagues, if I'm wrong, that the highest percentage of people who will suffer about this is the African-American community and the Latinos. And not much in Argentina, but there are so many countries in South America that they are very poor and people don't have much education. And it's kind of common, unfortunately, for men to be with different women, not getting married, getting them pregnant, and the consequences of all that, in addition of poverty. So, you know, Argentina is a little bit more progressive in that way and protects women more. There is the law currently is that you can have an abortion up until the, I believe it's the 14th week of the conception, and it's not a minor thing because Argentina is a super Catholic country. And religion plays a big role, especially Catholicism plays a big role in this, you know, abortion stuff. So again, my view is like, wow, how is it possible that for 50 years or more, 73 was the way, almost 50 years, it has been such a great law, and then overturned. What a mess.
Michelle?
So I think, oi, and I think, oi, on so many levels, but particularly in the sense that Jews are such a small minority of this country, but we have such important wisdom to bring to bear here that I feel like I would have hoped, you know, that we would have been able to share it with the broader culture in more articulate ways throughout these past years. Because the conversation in America is so polarized. It's so, you know, either you're murdering babies or it's my body, my choice. And I think our Jewish tradition just is so wise on this level. They say our tradition feels that there is sanctity to a life that you begin. It's you would want to do everything you possibly could to avoid terminating a life. But if the health, the economic or mental stability of a woman or a family is at stake, then there are reasons to terminate, and there are reasons that to prioritize the health and life of the mother, the person who stands before you. The baby has not yet been born. The woman herself is seen as having value, as having sort of priority in how we think about the world. We think about how can we help this human and this, sometimes in a family unit, this family unit to thrive in this world. And I just wish that we could bring that Jewish lens into this conversation.
Yeah, so I guess a pivot, Michelle, to the sources that I sent out in the teaser. These are two statements from the Rabbinical Assembly. The Rabbinical Assembly is the union of conservative rabbis. And what's so striking to me is, as I shared it in the teaser, is that on just about every issue, you name the issue, it's two Jews, three opinions, two Jews, four opinions. On every issue, think about the Sidur, the Avod, the Mahor, do we add Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, Leah, or not? Multiple opinions. And on this issue, which is such a hot political issue, to your point, Michelle, the rabbis of the Rabbinical Assembly, in the statements that I sent you, are uniform that if the continuation of the pregnancy would cause, I mean, here's the language, continuation of the pregnancy might cause severe physical or psychological harm, or where the fetus is judged by competent medical opinion as severely defective, the mother has the right to get an abortion. And the Rabbinical Assembly is four square against any efforts to impede that right. And by the way, it's in the determination, it's a subjective standard. It's the mother's standard. It's her psychological harm. It's her physical harm. And there's not two Jews, three opinions. There's she should be able to get this abortion, and therefore, be it further resolved that the Rabbinical Assembly urges members to support full access for all individuals to the entire spectrum of reproductive health care and to oppose all efforts by federal, state, local, or private entities or individuals to limit such access, and be it further resolved that the Rabbinical Assembly call on our colleagues, that's us, to continue to protect reproductive freedom through education, advocacy, and coalition building. So this moment, I just want to frame it. This moment is really, and I want to step back. You know, from 2016 to 2020, it was a season of some challenging politics. And then the election cycle of 2020 was a season of some challenging politics. And like every faith community in America, Jewish and not Jewish, we struggled with what's our voice. Do we talk about our sacred texts, or do we talk about the world, etc.? And you know, it was a very hard season, and you know, we lost members on both sides of the spectrum who thought we did it wrong. We got all kinds of critiques, etc. And we tried to teach Torah, but at the end of it, kind of where we emerged after the election and after the challenges to the election was, let's talk. Let's talk Torah. And it feels like this is a moment that challenges that paradigm. Because our authority, the Rabbinical Assembly, our movement is literally calling on us. I mean, I just read it. Calling on us to educate, to advocate, to challenge. In other words, to be like good Reformed Jews, to get involved in politics.
Right, but actually what they're calling on us to do is let's talk Torah. Right? In the sense, our Jewish tradition has such profound wisdom here that if we could, we have a religious, moral voice.
Right.
That actually, if we were to go out and connect with the people
right.
who are pushing the current Supreme Court's agenda here, or at least as it's playing out in the draft, if we were to have a religious conversation, here are the religious moral values that we see when we interpret our texts. You have these texts as well. Let's talk about the sanctity of life and how we honor the sanctity of life while preferencing the sanctity of the life before us.
But, okay, so and we could talk about
yes,
that.
Yes, talk
yeah,
Torah.
Yeah, but I just want to note that what the RA, the Rabbinical Assembly, seemingly asking us to do is to get involved in the public square of ideas, to get out of Ring 24, 25, where we are now, to get out of 385 Ward Street, where we all live, and to get out into the world. And it feels like it's asking us to do marches. It feels like it's asking us to rally the troops and march on Washington. That's what it feels like it's asking us to do through education, advocacy, and coalition building. The coalition building, that's a political thing. So they're saying, you know, not enough to be in the Gan Chapel or the Rabbitchel Sanctuary or in the classroom. Get out into the world and advocate, because in this case, politics is Torah. Torah is politics. The dividing line between politics and Torah, which might have applied to a political election or not, we can debate that forever, but that distinction does not apply to this issue. Now, politics is Torah. Go out and advocate and teach. And my question to you is do you take that message to be what they're saying? And if so, what does that mean to your work at Temple Emanuel? Elias.
So I remember years ago, those of us who have kids, we know how kids could be different, and they are raised in the same house, and they end up being so different. We took Mikey as a toddler to the beach, and I said, Mikey, you have sand here. Why don't you do a sand castle? Yes, but where are the instructions? He said. You know, he was so used to do Legos, and so where am I going with this? To me, these are the instructions that I need to go out into the world. It's very different for me to, when the congregant asked me, you know, do you like this political leader or this political leader? Do you like this president or what that president? No, you are more to the right. No, you are more to the left. There was no unified voice from Judaism that would show us the roadmap. This, the unanimity of this, it's a clear roadmap to me as a Jew and how to behave in the world. So answering your question, if I go to a march supporting, you know, the laws protecting women, I have this behind me, and I can show to everybody, and I feel much more comfortable talking about politics when this is behind me, giving me the roadmap.
And can I ask a question, Elias, about your character? and your temperament and your disposition. We all know you love to sing, and we all know you love to teach music, and we all know that you love to inspire a community of song. Are you personally comfortable with this new move of getting in a bus and rallying your friends and colleagues here to go, you know, march in favor of reproductive freedom? Are you personally comfortable with that role? Because that's a different role.
So basically, this is an unusual moment. Using your words, this is an epic moment. The fact that the conservative movement says one thing, like aligning in one thing, how many times have we seen this?
Never.
Okay. So this, to me, it's a fascinating time, and definitely, if I have to say, okay, enough with the sun, let's go and protest, I'll do it.
I also want to say, this is not just about abortion. This is about, there was a woman in the South who was charged with murder for having a miscarriage. This is about the potential for women and doctors to be put behind bars for the fact that 10% of pregnancies or some not unreasonably small number of pregnancies end in miscarriage without any fault. This is that people are going to be criminalized for actions that are beyond their control. This is about protecting people from having to carry a pregnancy to term, knowing that their child will suffer and die within hours of being born. This is about protecting people's quality of life, not just about the decision about whether or not to terminate a pregnancy. And so what our movement is saying is that we have to stand up, we have to protect life, we have to protect each other, and that to me is absolutely clear. What feels not clear is we, I think, are lulled into the sense of false security living here, and it's, in some ways we are safe and we are supported and we have laws here in Massachusetts that protect us, but I'm really concerned that we need much more definitive action. I don't know exactly what that looks like, but it does feel like we need to be doing much more than going to marches and making sure that we are protected moving forward.
What can you spell out what this moment asks of us?
I think it asks of us to be flooding all of our representatives' offices with calls, not just those here in Massachusetts, but nationally. I think it requires of us to be taking to the streets. I think it requires of us to be making it clear that this is not just an issue of abortion. This is an issue of protecting life, and that it's crazy. It's also an issue of supporting the children that have not yet, right? If there's right. Really pro-life things, it has to be supporting all children.
Can I zoom out for a second? Because here's where I get into my land of darkness, and maybe you guys can help me out. You know, Michelle, you talk about the sources and the wisdom and the insights that Judaism has, and if we can only bring that to the public square. But imagine the public square. Like, what is the actual public square? And I guess my darkness comes from the deep and fundamental and perhaps irremediable and very basic foundational brokenness of our country. We're a country where, you know, 72 million voted for one candidate, 75 million voted for the other candidate. But the 72 million who voted for the one candidate, you know, most of them actually approved of this. In fact, they voted for that candidate so that we would get justices who would do this. And it doesn't feel like it's something that, like, you could reason with somebody about. It doesn't feel like, even if you could imagine a world where the 72 million who voted for that candidate to put these justices in to roll back Roe v. Wade, if you could be in a classroom with them and serve them some coffee and some bagels and have a classroom and create an atmosphere, just imagine. And then we have our sources. It doesn't feel like it would work. And it feels like this is a deeply emotional issue. It's a jersey wearing issue. Do I wear the red jersey or the blue jersey? It's a group identity issue. It's not susceptible of reason. It's not susceptible of conversation. And we're fundamentally split, 75 million, 72 million. And so this grows out of the brokenness of our nation. And it doesn't feel like there's a remedy. So that even if Temple Emanuel were to mobilize, and let's say Temple Emanuel were as unified as the Rabbinical Assembly, and let's say we got on buses and we drove to Washington, what then? And so when I think about it coming, this whole issue comes out of national brokenness, which feels terminal to me. and irremediable to me. That's when I go dark. And so I'd love wisdom from you about how to not go dark. Mr. Nessie.
It may seem a little trite, but, you know, we know that we have the obligation to act whether we believe it's going to be efficacious or not. You know, that, you know, if not now, when? You know, is our mantra. So, yes, I can. I feel your darkness. I feel that too. On the other hand, by not acting, you know, by being silent, we are in essence condoning. So we need to act.
To me, I'm much more drawn at this moment to the kind of work that Rabbi Chiel did. You know, Rabbi Chiel confronted a Catholic world that was very anti-Semitic and said, let's sit down and talk and see where we can learn Torah together, what you call Bible, and see if we can build bridges. And to me, you know, I'd love to find some way over the next few months or years to be able to sit with some of these communities on that other side of the divide and to hear from them their interpretations of their religious understanding and to try to share our interpretation as Jews of this that comes from those same sources that they hold holy, because I can tell you what's not working. What's not working is making this only a political issue. And so I have to find a little bit of hope in the possibility that maybe if we could sit down and learn together, they could come to see that it's not all or nothing. And maybe we could come to see that it's not all or nothing, that there can be reasonable decision-making based on prioritizing life all around, not only the life of the unborn child, but the life of the woman as well.
Michelle, are you advocating for us to, like, go to Iowa, go to Tennessee?
No, Rabbi Chiel did this here in Massachusetts. He made connections.
Michelle, but can I ask a question about that? If the court issues the opinion, or some version of it, and now Roe is struck down, and now all the parade of horribles that you've mentioned are reality, is that going to help?
If the law can change once, it can change again. I mean, if you build communities that care enough that advocate for particular policies that currently are swung so far to either this side or that side, if we could try to come together as religious communities to consensus positions, I don't know, might be totally impossible. But lo alecha hamlecha ligmor. And I think just marching in the streets continues to polarize. And what this country so desperately needs, in my opinion, are people who sit down and say, you worship the same God I worship. Can we talk about how we do that?
And Michelle, yes. I just want one more thing about that. It feels to me, what I was thinking about when you were speaking was, I once was talking to a friend of mine who's a doctor. And he said that very often the conversation with the patient is the therapy, right? Like seeing the patient and hearing the patient and listening to the patient and having empathy for the patient and doing what you can do for the patient, that is the therapy. And if you can actually make them feel better, that's even gravy. But the encounter is the therapy. And I'm still at the level. We have two issues. One is how to solve this problem for our nation, but how to confront the problem without going dark. And what I'm hearing from you is I kind of like this idea that you're offering up, if I understand it correctly, which is by doing the work, that's the therapy. By having a conversation, that's the therapy. And that can buy you a little light. That can buy you hope. That can buy you light in a world of darkness, that you're doing something about it. Even if you don't fix it, you're working on it, and that's your life.
Yeah, and more importantly, you don't do that kind of work unless you believe that your sources are strong enough to convince somebody to say there's an alternative vision and view that's actually functional and productive and honors sanctity of life, which is what you're invested in. Instead of calling the other side and saying, you know, you're evil and you just want to destroy, you say, I see what you're trying to go for. Let me tell you how my tradition approaches that, and maybe we can offer you another window and another way to do this in a way that's respectful.
So with, I want to talk a little bit about what you brought up about the darkness. I have a completely different approach in life in general. I was born in a country that was very anti-Semitic from the time that I was born, so I always knew that darkness was part of my life, right? And that's my vision throughout the world. It's like there are always times of darkness. And but sometimes what we do in a selfish way, I'm talking about in general human beings, is like, I'm healthy. My kids are healthy. I have a great job. So I have enough reasons to be happy, even though the world is a dark place. Okay? So you said 2016 to 2020. So the question for you is the following. Before 2016, I heard you doing sermons and bringing messages like, for example, conservative Jews are not seen in Israel because they don't have rights. And if I remember correctly, you said once in the pulpit, I don't want to live in Israel like that because Israel doesn't represent me, you know, the Orthodox and doesn't. So there was always darkness there. So to what extent the darkness you are naming now is that before 2016, the darkness was somewhere else. And now the darkness is closer to you because you have friends or family members who think differently than you.
Yeah, so thank you for that question, Elias. I mean, it's very possible for me, if I shut out the world, to not feel darkness at all. I love Temple Emmanuel. I love our families here. I love the work here. I am so blessed to be married to Sheila, you know, every day. I love our kids. We love our kids. I love you guys. I love our colleagues. So I can make it through a day loving life and feeling light and feeling no darkness. And the only problem with that is I feel that that's irresponsible to do day after day in a world where the changes that we're talking about are happening. And I feel like I have a responsibility. I mean, you mentioned Rabbi Chill. I always wonder, what would Rabbi Chill do? And, you know, Rabbi Chill, when 2016 happened, my go-to source was Rabbi Chill. And, you know, we're familiar in Newton at Temple Emmanuel with his books of sermons from his Temple Emmanuel years. Those are the sermons we're blessed to hear. But he had a completely different voice in the 1960s when he was talking about civil rights, when he was talking about the war in Vietnam. And I remember him telling me that the South gets the press for being racist, but no one's more racist than New York Jews, that were in his congregation. That there's nobody in the South that could be more racist than the congregants that he was speaking to, trying to educate them around civil rights. And and he spoke that truth. And I think it ended up, he encountered the same kind of frictions and resistance that we did. And I think when he came here, that voice, the firebolt. I remember once reading one of his sermons, and I was getting goosebumps, and I ran into Michelle's office, and I said, "Hey, Michelle, does this?" And I read her this piece. It was from a sermon in the 60s about civil rights, about seeing Black Americans, about institutional racism. And I said, you know, and it was amazing. It was amazing. He's like the greatest rabbi ever. And I said, "Does that sound like Rabbi Chill?" And she said that that's not the Rabbi Chill she ever heard. And so I think there are these voices.
Can I add to that? But the Rabbi Chill that I heard was a consensus builder.
A consensus builder, a world
builder.
Right.
And he actually, I think, in his, at least what I saw in the chapter that I saw of his life,
right,
he dedicated it to building real deep connections between faith communities that was tremendously inspiring.
Right.
So it helped some of those values
move
more seamlessely
into
to win hearts with mine.
So it turns out, right, so I think if somebody were doing a PhD dissertation around Rabbi Chill's career, they would see a move from the fiery preacher that he was in Malvern in the 60s to the, to your point, super successful consensus builder, coalition builder of his Temple Emmanuel years in ways that made the world more just. So to answer your question, I always have that idea. I always have his example in my head rattling around. And on a day where I just work at Temple Emmanuel and then come home after Minyan and watch the NBA playoff games and go to sleep, I think I'm not doing my part.
Oh, no, but my question was more that why is it that you don't feel that before 2016 there was no darkness?
No, there was darkness. There was always, there's always darkness. I mean, there's always darkness. But this feels, you know, I read, of course, you've all read a lot of articles about it, but one person said something that really captured my attention. It was in the Times, I forget who wrote it. That this is as if, to Elu, the Supreme Court were reversing Brown versus Board of Education and reinstating Plessy versus Ferguson. Right? Some think, guys, it's not my idea. Somebody
said. New York Times editorial board.
New York Times editorial, right, okay. Right, that this is like reversing Brown and reinstating Plessy. That's just a degree of darkness that is thicker and more palpable than any that I've experienced in my lifetime. To think that that would be happening to women with all of the, you know, economic and socioeconomic implications we talked about. So that's why it really comes close home. So I wanted to just, just in our last few seconds, just talk about, so Michelle, you offered up what I can do to confront the real world and not be dark. And that is education, coalition building, discussion. Dan and Elias and Aliza, we'd like to ask you, how can we confront the real world and make some contribution and not go dark while doing it?
I'll start because I have, I think, probably the darkest perspective. I think it's actually really important to go dark. It actually feels really important to me to name the darkness that you know, even before this happened, if you wanted to go get care at Planned Parenthood, you had to walk through pictures and signs and protesters that made you see horrible things. And it's time for us to own the darkness and to use that power of our grief and our anxiety and our fury to make changes and to not allow our country to be held hostage by this kind of hateful law.
To me, the conservative Jewish voice needs to be heard, because this rabbinical statement is, who reads it? Us. Right? And but it needs to get out into the world.
I remember, I'm old enough to remember that there was a Planned Parenthood center on Beacon Street in Brookline that was, and I was like literally several hundred feet away when it was blown up. It feels like history is reversing itself. I don't know what a plan is. I agree with you that we have to delve into the darkness in order to be able to then move forward to try to find the light. I don't know what that would look like though.
So I love classes that you don't wrap up neatly with a bow and get wrap. And this is a class that we don't wrap up with a bow and a gift wrap. So I guess I want to leave everyone with a question, not with an answer, which is, it does feel like this is a moment that is different from 2016, from 2020. This just feels like a historic moment. It does feel like it calls upon each of us to act individually. It feels like it calls upon our synagogue to act in a way that is categorically different, paradigmatically different from our comfort zone. Our comfort zone is praying, singing, saying Kaddish, learning, you know, doing cult drives, helping refugees. Who could argue with any of that, right? This, and that's all valid and should continue, but this feels like a different category that is asked of us now. And to Elias's point, we actually have Torah unanimous. Uniform toward driving us to this. And the question is, how do we engage this moment, this issue, and keep our light, and keep our joy, and keep our sense of blessing and not succumb to the darkness. I love, Michelle, your idea that the therapy is in the encounter, that the therapy is in the work, that the therapy is in the doing. So let's get started. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.